word speak through me, and whatever he has to say to you, I pray that you guys would just be attentive, listen to what he has to say to you, and not just listen, but go out there and apply it to your lives. So once again, welcome. If this is your first time at Destiny, you are the guest of honor this morning. We appreciate you coming. We have child care in the back that the kids can go to after we worship here. We have coffee, and we have a place you need to stop by back there at our welcome center, and they'll give you a nice little gift, and we'll pass around some sign-in sheets so we know who you are, and maybe we can get to know you a little bit better. So that's what that's about. So if you're here today and you're ready to worship the Lord, and you're excited about that, we're going to. And I pray that we just drop everything that we got going on out there. I know it's going to be a beautiful day and people can't wait. Now, we'll get you out of here by 3. Don't you worry about that. I've called KFC. They're going to save some chicken for you. So we're ready to go. Are you guys ready again? All right, I think everybody's about in right now. Might have to pry out a couple of those greeters at the door because they're close to that sun. But we're even closer to the sun, right? So, praise God. This morning, if you see in the back of your chairs, there's tithe envelopes. If you want to tithe or give above that, feel free. We have a box out there that you can drop it into. And every week, we don't take up an offering here. You guys are free to fill out those envelopes and hand them in. But that's between you and the Lord this morning. And we pray that you would just be obedient to what he's blessed you with. You know, God has given us so much, and we take so much of that for granted in this world. Just the ability to be here today, the ability to come in and sing, pray, and worship, and look around and enjoy each other's fellowship and the friends that we have. And I want to just start today by reading Proverbs chapter 3, verse 9. Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine. You know, we take for granted that God has blessed us, and we give a little bit more. And all of a sudden, he blesses us with even more. And we don't, it's hard for us to comprehend what we have is his. And it's just it's a matter of faithfulness. It's a matter of he gives us a little bit to trust him with, and then when we show that we can't trust him, we get even more. So it's better than any 401k plan, I'll tell you that. So praise God. If you're giving this morning, I'd like to just take this time to bow our heads, and we'll pray over this offering and this service this morning. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for allowing us to come out. We thank you for the weather. We thank you for our families. We thank you for this church. We thank you for a place that we can come and worship you, Lord, and we just drop everything at your feet this morning, and we empty of ourselves of our attitudes and our agendas and our control, and we just come before you empty, and God, we just want to kneel at your feet and praise you this morning. And God, the offerings that are given this morning, we pray that we be used to upbuild your kingdom, Lord. Father, I pray for a blessing on the people, but more than anything, I pray that you would be glorified through this giving. And Father, that you would be glorified from every word that's spoken today. And God, that this church service will not just be a nice church service, but God, something that's pierced into our hearts that we would take out into this world and we could put some actions behind. And Father, you have control of all that. And we just pray that you would be glorified through every word that's said, every song that's sang. And God, every ministry that's done here today, we pray that you have your hand in. And God, that you would just speak to us. So we thank you, we praise you, and God, we ask for your blessing upon this day, this offering, and the upbuilding of thy kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
I'm ready as the worship team comes. Guys, dig in and worship, all right? Forget about the neighbors, forget about if you're off key a little bit. Just go like this. You see those old Baptists? Wonder why they go like this when they're singing? It's probably that person next to them. I'm just kidding. But let down your hair a little bit and get into this. So
us this morning to worship the Lord?
With the sinner's restless heart.
bow your heads with me. Lord, we are truly lost without you. Without your guidance, without your love, without your unconditional love, we are lost. Today, Lord, we sing these songs of praise to you. We thank you so much for the ability to be called children of God. How awesome is it to be able to stand here before you, to love you, to praise you for all that you do for us. The very air that we breathe, Lord, is provided by you. How can we, as a people, ever thank you enough for the love that you've given us? We thank you for the music, for our abilities to praise you with our song. Lord, you could have had anybody standing here today, but this morning, for some reason, you chose us. Good or bad or indifferent, Lord, we love you. And we thank you. And we thank you for all the blessings that you've given us. Even on our worst day, Lord, you're still there for us. Even on our best day, Lord, you're still there with us. We give you all the praise, all the glory, Lord, for all that you do. We love you so much. Please open the hearts of everybody in the congregation today to hear Mark's message and pierce his heart, Lord, so that the Holy Spirit overwhelms him with wisdom and knowledge to share your word. Because, Lord, it's your word that we want to hear today. We want to hear your word and we want to take it away from here so that we can apply it. Because, Lord, without you we're nothing. We are truly, truly lost without you. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Bring me sorrows and trials.
Jesus is coming. Oh, oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open.
Father, in your word it says that Jesus is the bread of life. And he that cometh after him shall never hunger. He that believeth in him shall never thirst. And God, you put us in a grocery store at one time here. That God fed us for a day. That gave us enough liquid for a few days. And God, you put us in here and you tell us about a well that will feed us and give us water of life for eternity. God, we praise you for that. We praise you for the well that we can come to. We praise you for the altar that's available to us. We praise you for your word. We praise you for what we felt in our hearts just communicating with you right there. God, we praise you today. We bow at your feet and surrender before you today. God, if there's one here today that's never tasted living waters of that well, God, I pray for that one. God, feed us, fill us, revive us. Help us not to survive, but to thrive. We love you, and we pray for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. I am shake one another's hands, greet one another. Make sure you welcome this praise team back. We have missed them.
Prayer with those, share healthy recipes that you've found throughout the week, and then you're going to go out and walk for 45 to 60 minutes, depending on how long the group can all walk. So come Wednesday night and get started on a healthier way to live your life, okay? We have Ladies Night Out coming back May 14th, and they're going to do a canvas painting again. Tiffany Rawls is in charge of that. That'll be at 6:30, and there will be a salad bar and dessert bar. So if you want to invite ladies that don't come to church here to come with you, invite them and bring them out. That's May 14th at 6:30. I'm taking a class right now, and Wednesday night I had a missionary that came, and he had a really good analogy I want to share with everybody. he said that people, when he does this class, people always say, I can't move to another country to do missions work. I can't do this. I can't do that. I have a job. I have this. I have that. All I can do is pray. And he said, people always say, all I can do is pray. And he said, I think, all you can do is pray? He said, you know, a sergeant in the military might say, I don't have any guns to fight this war. I don't have any artillery to go to fight this war. All I have is an atomic bomb. An atomic bomb could take care of everything. That is what our prayer can do. We are praying through an almighty God that's living inside of us that can do anything. We need to stop looking at prayer as all we can do and look at it as God can do anything. And we have a prayer meeting right now at 6:30 on Tuesday nights, and I really encourage people to come out and pray. There's so many things we can pray about. Pray without ceasing, the Bible says. So come out on Tuesday nights at 6:30, and Karen Alt will get us all praying. Okay, we have a bake sale today out here in the entry. That is, all that money goes to Relay for Life. We have a team actually walking May 19th for Relay for Life, so buy some baked goods when you leave to support that. Joyce Meyer Conference, I booked the motel rooms. Not all of our rooms are full with four people, so if you still want to go to Joyce Meyer, you're welcome to go with us. Just see me. We changed our email at Destiny again. We're now with Constant Contact, which means we have a new email address. So you can see it up here. It's office@destinyfamilyoffaith.com. So change your contacts to contact the office. Little Domino's Preschool. Is Tammy in here or is she teaching? She's teaching. You'll see Leonard up here on the board. He's going to be our preschool pet for that class. And we still are enrolling. We still have some openings in our preschool. There's Leonard. And we enrolled a child this week from Avila, so we were pretty excited about that. But she would really love to fill those sessions, so get the word out. There are flyers on the Welcome Center to hang up in the community or hand out. And I believe that's it, Mark. Thank you.
A lot going on. A lot to get involved with. We're going to talk about getting involved. And, I enjoyed the worship. I don't know if the team's still in here, but I'm happy to see them. I know that they deserved a couple of weeks off in Florida, I guess, most of them. But I didn't get to go, but oh well. And Pastor and Karen went to Texas, so we'll give them a week off. And he's got, he went to an exciting conference, they went to an exciting conference, and I can't wait for him to share that with some of us. And I'm sure he will, he's probably chomping at the bit right now, but I'm going to give him a little time off, since he didn't have time to maybe study, or we wanted his mind on something else during the time. So I'm going to try to fill in this week, which means I'm going to try to just get out of the way, like I told you before, and see what the Lord has in store for us. And I'm going to open up the scripture to us, and then you rightly divide the word of scripture. You see how he's talking to you. You see how he's leading you. Because, you know, as I was going through a lot of the my pre-sermon preparations and reading the Bible a little bit and going back to some old messages, and, you know, I went through some old messages and I was looking for some illustrations, and I'm like, wow, this message just keeps talking to me and speaking to my heart. And so we're going to talk today about unity and commitment. Ouch, lock the doors, Tom, again. We might have to lock the door for Tom. I don't see him in here. See, unity and commitment. We already had one gone. I'm just kidding. But it's just been impressed on my heart that you know, God has given us so many gifts, so many talents, so many abilities to get involved, to help. And it seems like sometimes we get so divided in life, and we don't know how to get involved, because we still want to be so involved with this and that, and there's so many good things going on, but a lot of good things, all of a sudden you can't focus your real attention, your real gift on the thing that really matters. So we're going to talk about that. And I read an illustration one time about the peanuts, and Lucy came in, and Linus was watching TV, and Lucy said, "Hey, change it to Channel 5. And Linus turns over and says, "What gives you the authority and the right and the power to think you can just tell me what to do?" And she says, "These five fingers. Individually, they're not much, but when I curl these things together, they form a weapon that you don't want to fight against." And then Linus turns, after changes the channel, he goes, "Why can't you guys come together like that?" I know, I tell some of the same illustrations. Some of you guys might have heard that. But isn't that the truth? You know, individually, as the church body, you know, out here, we're not that strong, it seems like. You know, we do a lot, and we know that God has our back, but it seems sometimes that we're on the island. But all of a sudden, when it's two, and it's three, it's four, and it's five, this church can pack a powerful punch, and we can affect this community. You know, we were talking about this morning, I don't want to be just a nice church. I want to be an effective body of Christ. I want to go out here and pack a serious punch to this community. And I want them to know that God wants to move in this town. You know, I've brought up the Coca-Cola model before, that we think globally, but we act locally. And Coca-Cola, you know, I'm not a big Coca-Cola fan, but that motto is always stuck with me, because a lot of times I can't touch around the world. You know, maybe we give a little bit to missions, or maybe we have a missions group going sometimes, but I can affect people who all of a sudden can affect around the world. I can affect this community, and we can affect this community. But too many times Satan has came in and divided us. He has torn things apart, and too many times we've came in and we've divided us, and not blaming or not even giving Satan any credit for that. We've done it to ourselves, but we've divided our families. We've been divided on the job. We've been divided in our homes, and we get busy with our own agendas all the time, and I'm not saying it's bad to be busy, and we all have busy times in our lives, but how many times do we just sit down before God and think, "God, what direction do you want me to go?" Because God is in the relationship building, not the tearing down. And we know divide is going to conquer. And Satan's conquered too many of our families, too many of our churches, too many of our friendships. And we've been divided. So I want us to talk about the unity today. And I want us to talk about commitment with that unity. So we're going to look at, as we get started here, Romans chapter 12, verse 4. And we'll read on through 10 if you have your Bibles and want to follow along. It says, "Just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same function, so in Christ we who are many form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given us. If a man's gift is prophesying, let him use it in proportion to his faith. If it is serving, let him serve. If it is teaching, let him teach. If it is encouraging, let him encourage. If it is contributing to the needs of others, let him give generously. If it's leadership, let him govern diligently. If it is showing mercy, let him do it cheerfully. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. To be honest, that caught me a little off guard. It was a little different version than my NIV. But it comes down to, it's the same stuff. It's just a couple of different words when talking about them. In accordance with your faith, if we're called, if we have a gifting to serve, then serve. If it's teaching, teach. If it's giving, give. We're a big body with lots of different abilities. And too many times we come in here and we see somebody else in the body that we think can do the job, and we have the kidney part of the body attitude. There's another kidney. This body will survive without me. And we can't have 150 kidneys here. We've got different abilities, different people that can teach, and they need to teach because it's their gifting, and not say somebody else can teach, and not give it the responsibility to somebody else. If God has blessed you with this gift, and it says to each of us we were given, to each, that means you have some gifting. I want us to examine ourselves and look in that mirror. What is my gifting? And use it. If it's teaching, teach. If it's prophesying, prophesy. If it's being a leader, lead. And if it's not your calling, maybe you shouldn't be involved in it like that. Now, that's the hard part, right? Because we all want to be involved because we want to have a little control. And some of us think that if I wasn't called to be the brain, I'm going to step out. If I wasn't called to be in control, if I can't control it, I'm going to step out. God has given you special gifting, a special purpose in the gift or in the body, a special gift. And a lot of us, we have gifts here today. You know, maybe it's not all the same gifts. Maybe we're all not called to sing. We're all not called to be the pastor. We're all not called to teach. But if you are, and you know you are, then why aren't you stepping up to that spot that God has blessed you to have? He's given you the gift. Many of us, we take the attitude like that kidney, and we think, you know what, I'm going to be great at the nursery, but I'm not signing up for anything. There's not going to be no commitment here. If somebody comes to me one day out of the blue, 3 years from now, and says, we need somebody in the nursery because they didn't show up, then I'm going to say, here I am. Where the last 3 years, somebody has been doing way too much nursery work or way too much cleaning work. I don't think there's any big gifts and small gifts. I think it's just part of the body. You know, we often talk about from pastoring down to cleaning. I think without the clean church, there's going to be no pastoring. We all need to do our part. We all have the special gifts. We all have abilities, and we all need to examine ourselves, see what those abilities are, and step up to the plate a little bit. All right, let me give you my email address. So when all the complaints come in, it's mallball. I'm just kidding. But we know, sometimes we know we fall short, and we know that somebody else can do it, so we just want to make it easier, and it puts so much pressure on so many people, and God didn't intend it that way. You know, we've all heard the analogies of we're like the box of crayons, and even though we're all different colors and all different sizes and lengths, and we've been used to paint different pictures, we all go in the same box. We're all part of the same set. And in this spiritual body, this church of Christ, you know, some of us crayons, we're worn down a little thin, and there's just barely enough to write anymore. And we're getting up there in age, or we've been given way too much, and we're burnt out. And some of us are brand new, and they're just starting the ministry. And there's too many black and whites that have been used, and they're down to the very end where the gray never wants to even apply themselves. Well, you can use black and white. You got black and white. You don't need gray right now. So we find ourselves in our comfort zone and not wanting to give too much or apply too much. And many times it's because we've been divided. We've been divided. The body has been divided. We've got so many things going on that instead of focusing on what your gifting is, we're trying to be involved in 10 different things. And I guess I'm trying to tell you that if you're involved in too much and you're not effective in anything, maybe drop some things, cut some things out. God has given you the gifting. Be diligent to what you're called to do. Just like it said up here, if it's teaching, teach. You guys don't have to say, you know, I'll wait for the next phone call that says the lawn needs mowed, and then I'll sign up for it, or the next snow removal, or the next ramp. If you're a carpenter, and God has blessed you with that, you know, why are people showing up that have no knowledge whatsoever, no calling, they're just there to help? You know, and if you're a helper, that's fine too, but those guys that know, or those girls that know this stuff, and you know that God has blessed you with that talent, you know, Pastor Mike shouldn't have to call out all the time. There should be some phone calls to him. When are we building that next ramp? Because God has blessed me with this ability, and I know I need to use it for the kingdom. And there's certain phases in our lives, Ecclesiastes tells us, that certain times, there's certain seasons that we need to rest, and there's certain seasons that we need to work, and there's certain times we need to step up, and there's certain times where we need to step back and let somebody else, the Timothy, start to get a little bit of that, right? And we all need to raise up that Timothy. We all have, responsibilities that grow that next generation, that grow the next minister, that grow the next teacher, that grow the next servant to this community so God can get glory. We all have a responsibility, but too many times today, I'm heard, and I told you this before, that the church is usually separated into three bodies. There's the wishbones, those who wish that things will get done and this church will grow. And then there's the jawbones, those who talk about things not getting done and want to talk about what could be done. And then there's the backbones that do everything. Well, just so you guys know, we're not going to post this, but the jawbone position has been filled. We don't need any more. The wishbones. We're good there too. It'd be nice to have a few more backbones. And I'm not saying get in there with everything you got and labor to the point of distress. I'm just saying what God has blessed you with, use that ability. Use the gifting that God has called you to do. If your life's too saturated with many things going on, get rid of some. You know, last week we were at our Marriage on the Rock class, and the minister was up there talking about how he had to get rid of golf for a while. He loved golf, but he eventually came back to it. But there's certain points in my life I remember getting rid of. I remember hunting seasons that I missed. I remember seasons of things that I like to do that I knew that there were other things more important at that time. And I gave on those things. And some of us, some of these things have become our God. Some of these things are first, and then it's God's somewhere down the line, 10th, 12th, somewhere down there. But we need to maybe refocus and look at this and decide that, you know what, I am in the body, and it's my job to encourage. It's my job maybe to show mercy. And it says that if this is what I'm called to do, if this is the gifting I've been given, I should use that gifting. Because it's not Pastor's Mike's job. He probably hadn't been called to all of that. A few things, yes. A few things, probably not. And he's probably trying to fill that role. And then somebody says, well, he's doing a pretty good job of it. But maybe it wasn't his, and you guys know it was yours. You know, and I got to look in the mirror on this big time. When I was reading this, I probably didn't choose this one over anything else for you guys. I chose it for me. Mark, if your gifting is whatever it is, do it. And quit depending on so many other people to do it. There's people that can sing that don't sing. There's people that can teach that don't teach. There's people that can mow that don't mow. There's people that can encourage that don't encourage. There's givers out there that decide that, you know what, this isn't the time or the cause, but it's your responsibility, it's your calling to give. There's all kinds of things out there, and only you guys know what your gifting is. It's not my job to judge. you're the one talking to the Lord right now. God, what have you called me? What have you gifted me with? What am I supposed to use for your glory, your kingdom, your purpose? And that's when I started with empty me of me. And God, fill me with you. And Father, what you want me to do, what you're speaking to me today to do, the purpose you have in my life, God, help me be obedient to that. God, help me drop off some of those hindrances and lay aside those weights that are going to easily beset me. And God, help me get to where I need to be. Verse 10 says, be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. And that's not always easy. The team concept's not always easy, especially when you look around and you think that, wow, they could be coming to practice a little bit more. When I think of team, I got to get to the sports section. Everybody who knows me knows I love my sports. So this is the sports section of the sermon today. To win a game, we need to score more points than the opponent, right? In most cases, don't ask me about my golf game. But we need to score more points. So I read about Ed Too Tall Jones, who used to play for the Cowboys. Maybe some of you guys have heard of him, but he's an old football player. Played for 23 years. Never scored one point. Not one. Went to the Hall of Fame. Never scored. You put him on a team by himself, would have never won a game. But he had a lot of batted passes, a lot of interceptions, a lot of fumble recoveries, a lot of tackles. He was a great teammate. He did all that. But by himself, he was nothing. But part of the team, they could win. Some of us, we're not called to score the touchdown. We're called to set up the block. We're called to make a few tackles. You know, when I think of a pastor, I often think of those quarterbacks on ESPN where all of a sudden when things are going good, they're getting all the praise. When things are going bad, man, they're in every tabloid and they're being cut down. And Pastor Mike has a lot of responsibilities. And sometimes he's doing the best he can, but when the church is good, woo, we're praising him. When the church is bad, we're talking about him. We're beating him down. That quarterback has hit me in the ankles instead of the hands every time. But yet, we're the team. It's not just the quarterback. The quarterback is nothing without the offensive line. The quarterback can't score more points than the other team if we don't have a defense, if we don't have an Ed Too Tall Jones. And we need to act as a team. Team, T-E-A-M, together, each accomplishes more. Team, I want a teammate that I can go to when I have an important prayer request. I want a teammate to go to when I've just been tackled and I'm laying there on the ground hurting. I want a teammate to go to that when I fumbled the ball and I messed up in my life, they're there just to love me. Because I've done every one of those, and I'm sure you guys have too. We go through periods in our lives when the team needs to protect us, when the team needs to comfort us, when the team needs us to just take a few plays off. But it's a team, and we need to realize it's a team. And together, each of us accomplishes more. And in this team, in this body of Christ, we need people to do the part that their gifting is part of. Guys, I don't want to stand up here today and ask you to do anything that you haven't been called to do. I don't want you to step out of your gifting, because I don't think that's what that scripture said. I want you to do what God has given you the gifts and the ability to do for his kingdom. Just like it says, if it's teach, teach. Pastor Mike always says up here, he stands up here and he goes, look, I know when I ask for nursery help, nobody's going to sign up, but a lot of times if we go to them personally, because up here, you don't get that team thing and when you're calling out names, but you guys know if you have been called to be the nursery teacher, and you know if somebody specifically asked you, then you're going to say, yeah, you know what, I can do that. I'm saying lift the game up enough as a team to, if you know you've been called to those positions, you go to who's heading that up and you ask. And you know what? If you're taking on too much and you're outside of your gifting, I'll even go this far to say, you know what? Back off if it's not your gifting. God wants you, and he's faithful to give you those gifts. And you know what? Of those gifts, just like the tithe, at least take 10% of that gift. Or if you're counting the days, one Sunday a week, seven. One day out of the seven, and maybe give an hour. Maybe it's not. And if everybody does that, then it's usually one day, 1 hour a year, because we usually have enough. And I'm not saying we don't have enough, and I don't know if we have enough or not. I am just saying that God didn't place you here and expect you not to use your gifting, because that verse of Scripture tells me right there that if you have the ability. You know, a lot of us think that, you know, I'm just young, I'm too young, I'm not ready for this. And as I was studying this part, I was thinking, wow, this hit me hard. I was thinking, too many of us, we take our baby steps forever, you know, because I'm not ready to step out on teaching alone, so I'll do this. I have been preaching for 15 years. I do roughly 3 or 4 sermons a year. And I was thinking, am I ready for some preaching yet? Because Pastor Mike and I have been talking about maybe doing some more preaching here. I got to look at myself in the mirror and say, you know what? Maybe I'm out of so much Timothy mode. Maybe I need to step up my game a little bit. You know, I've got to examine myself in that. And I've got to look in the mirror. And some of you guys need and have some gifting that you guys need to focus on too. You know what? Maybe I'm ready to do what God has taught me to do, asked me to do, given me the ability to do. And instead of saying why I can't do it, instead of taking baby steps and being under somebody for 15 years, maybe it's time to actually do it. Maybe it's time to step out. Maybe it's time to be part of the team and a good teammate. Yeah, if we're Christians, we're part of the team. We're in the body of Christ. But wouldn't it be so much more effective to this community if we could take all of our fingers and make the powerful weapon? So nobody's tired. Nobody's worn down. Everybody's got the zeal. Everybody's ready to go. And nobody has the attitude of, I need to be the brain, I need to be in control, or I'm not doing it. We need to find good teammates. We need to, in our own lives, I need to find a good teammate. I want to find a prayer warrior. I want to find an accountability partner. I want to find a teammate I can go to that they can show me the scripture that I need when I need the scripture. I need to find the teammate that I know can go to God when I have a serious, serious thing going on in my life. And I want prayer. I want prayer. When my kids are sick, I want prayer. And I'm going to find that teammate. And I'm going to find somebody I know that's showing the fruits of that vine. And the vine's not dead there. I want to see and seek these people on my team. And you are my people. I want you to realize that you are the people here. You are my people. We are the body of Christ. You know, everybody that I run across in the Bible seemed to have some teammates. And I was thinking of Moses and some of his teammates. And I was thinking of how he had Joshua at times, right? How he had Aaron. And I look at Hur. And Hur's only mentioned a couple of times in the Bible. But I think of Hur and how when Moses and the Israelites were fighting down there, and every time Moses lifted up his hands, the Israelites were winning. And when the hands dropped, they were losing the battle. And Hur had the job of just lifting up and help lifting up Moses' arms. That's all his job was. And he could have said, Moses, it's hot out here. I don't want to smell those pits. Could have walked away. There's no right guard. Moses, I'm not going to get enough. Sorry. Moses, I'm not going to get enough credit out here. There's not enough people watching. Moses, he could have came up with all kinds of complaints. There's no Gatorade. Somebody, Gatorade. It doesn't work like that. He had a job and responsibility. To some, it might not have been important. To that Israelite that was getting ready to lose his life because Moses' arms were down, it was important. It was a job that he had to be obedient to and faithful to. It was a job that he could have taken and said, you know what? Our leader's not doing a good enough job. He can't lift up his arms. He could have talked down Moses. He could have said, I'm a better one than Moses. But no, he was just faithful to his job and the gifting that God called him to do. Is that a big gift? I'm going to hold this guy's arms up. Doesn't seem like it. But it was a powerful gift. It got him in the Bible. Must have been a good gift, huh? I want us to use our gifting, guys. I want us to make a commitment to our gifting. Well, let's look at Hebrews chapter 12, verse 12. We'll read a couple scriptures here. Therefore, strengthen your feeble arms and your weak knees. Make level paths for your feet so that the lame may not be disabled, but rather healed. Make every effort to live in peace with all men and to be holy. Without holiness, no one will see the Lord. See to it that no one misses the grace of God and that no bitter root grows up to cause trouble and defile many. Wow, there's a lot there. There's a lot there. We will get out of here at 4. I am kidding. I'll get you out of here soon. Once I'm done, I'm done. When the Lord says shut it down, I'm shut down. That's just how it works for me. I can't help that. But guys, as we look at this scripture, I'm not asking you to do some crazy stuff. I'm not asking you to go out there and be super fanatical and get stoned or beheaded or crucified. I'm asking you to put forth enough effort that if some embarrassment comes, so be it. I'm doing it for the grace of God. If some hardship were to come, it's difficult to look at this and look at that and say, which one do I want to go to? And maybe I have to go to the one that I need to go to instead of the one that I might have a little fun. I'm asking you to give a little time. I'm asking you to give a little effort. I'm asking you to be obedient to the gifting God has given you. I'm asking you to just listen to what God has to say to you. You know, as we look at all these different gifts and we think, what am I committed to now? What am I committed to? And many of us, you know, there's times in my life where I was committed to money. I was committed to not being committed. I was committed to giving my kids everything that I never had. I was committed to things that I shouldn't have been committed to. We all have, and many of us, we come into church because we have to refocus and re-examine and make sure that we're going down the path that we should. And I have to come to church and I have to have sermons like this to put myself in check. And I hope you guys do too. Because it's easy to not be committed to studies and not be committed to open up your Bible so you're not so convicted. I want you to take a leap of faith. God, your word shows me that you gave me the gifts. Your word shows me that my abilities came from you. My gifting is the gifting that you trusted me with, and like that tithe, I want to give back. And like that, I know you'll bless more. I believe that with everything in me, that he will bless more than we can contain. I believe that. And I want us to believe that. And I want us to commit like, look, here's the example of me getting into the pool for all those who went to Florida. It's one toe, and then, 10 minutes later, and by the time I'm up to here, and I'm doing the Henrietta Hippo thing on my toes. You old people, you get the Henrietta Hippo. It's not a pretty sight. It is not a pretty sight. But, you know, an hour later, I'm in the water. And my son Luke, it's not like that. It's cannonball. It's all out. If I'm getting wet, so is everybody else. And I'm going to get it over with quick. I want us to do a spiritual cannonball. I want you to get wet. I don't want you to just take the 4 years to get your body into the water. I want that divine spiritual cannonball, and I want you to go in, and if some people get wet, get them wet. Get them wet. It'll help them get in quicker. It can be infectious. It can be contagious. Our gifting will grow up people. Our gifting will help the future Timothy's. Our gifting will be that knowledge that we can pass down, and our gifting will be support so other people don't have to support. When I'm looking at this scripture that we just read, and let's see where it has, therefore strengthen your feeble arms and your weak knees. You know what? Sometimes we get a little older, and sometimes we can't handle everything. And to strengthen that, a lot of times people have a crutch or some sort of support. And sometimes when we get tired and we need strength, you got those people that can offer support. We need those people, right? Sometimes you're the crutch, you're the support. And then we're talking about getting those paths level. Sometimes we got to get rid of the obstacles in the way. We need the support. We have the focus. We have the vision. We know what path we need to go down. We know what gifting we have. Now use it. And when those bitter roots pop up that we read about, let no bitter root grow up to cause trouble and defilement. Sometimes we got to take it out by the root and get rid of it. Man, but that looks so good in the garden. It's even got a little flower thing. But underneath, it's tying in with all the things that need life, and it's killing their life. Sometimes we have to purge the garden. You know what? If somebody's just tickling your ears and feeding you a bunch of baloney just because that's what you want to hear, not need to hear, don't let them tickle the ears anymore. You need to line yourself up with the Word of God. If it's not lined up with this, it might be that baloney. You know, I'm speaking today on something that's probably common knowledge, and maybe there's some here today, like there always are, that says, you know, I just needed the meat. I needed the meat, and we all have this milk. I tell you, there's no deep theological message here. There's no taking this back to the Greek word. There's no setting this up with the context of what was going on in that era. This is flat out simple. You want the meat? The meat is the action part of this. If you came in here looking for meat, apply it to your lives and see what that does for you. That's the meat. The word was easy to rightly divide today. And if you're falling short, the meat is apply it, apply it, apply it. Don't be a nice church anymore. Be a church that makes a difference. Don't be just a nice father anymore. Be a father that makes a difference. If you're calling to be a father, if that's your gifting, you be the best father you can be. You don't depend on a Sunday school teacher to raise that child up. That's just a Sunday thing. You raise that child up the way God would want you to raise that child. You be the best mom you can be. You be the best husband you can be. The best wife you can be. The best friend you can be. If that's your gifting, use it with everything in you. Got a little Baptist on me. The spit starts flying. You guys just let me know. It's good to laugh, isn't it? I love the Lord. Me and my son, just yesterday, he was telling me, you think God was that humorous? He made me, didn't he? He's got a sense of humor. I love the Lord with everything in me. And I fall short so many times of using my gifting as all do. All of us do. And sometimes when things pop up and I don't agree with them, I'll go back into my cave. And I'll give it the old, I'm the only one here, sermon to the Lord. And I'll bring up excuses. Well, they don't believe in the exact doctrine that I do. Or they don't believe in, I don't know, you can come up with tons of, you guys got, if you guys have, I'm sure everybody can think of an excuse to come up with right now off the top of their head why they're too whatever to do too whatever. We've all got them. But at the end of the day, one body. One body. We are the body. Do we love like we're supposed to do? Think about that scripture. You guys go home and you guys can really dig into that scripture, but are you where you need to be? Because this world has taken us in so many directions. There's an analogy I told you guys one time about this, a couple years ago, about this beautiful, picturesque lake, a river, and there was a waterfall at the end of it, and many people would come to see this, and it was just so beautiful, and the water would just drop over the edge, but most people would come at one certain time of the season, and it's when the birds would come down to feed. And the reason they would come down at this time of the year is because the birds would land on the ice and the fish would be frozen in the ice sometimes or by the ice. And the birds would land with their talons down and they would get a fish and they would sit there and eat. And by the time that the waterfall came, many of them would fly off the ice. But people came to watch because many times their talons were stuck in the ice. And when they went to fly, there was no flying. They went down the waterfall in that chunk of ice because their talons were stuck to it. And I always think about this analogy because so many times we want to get so involved with the world that we just think that we're going to be down in it and we're going to get down and dirty in the world just for a few minutes and we're out and we can just handle this for this phase of our life. But before we know it, our talons are stuck in there and we're attached to it and we can't get out of it. And we've gone farther than we want to go and we're deeper than we want to be in this. And there's no way out for us. Have you ever felt that? I don't know your situation today, but if you're not using your gifting like you should, what are you using it for? A lot of times we can look at everything outside of God's kingdom, can't we? I'm using it for this and that. I just want you to examine yourself today. That's it. I don't have, you know, something to tell you, you need to do this and that. This is between you and God. Not me. I'm just trying to reveal the scripture that God put on my heart and why he put it on my heart. It's what you choose to do with it. You can leave through these doors today and decide, yeah, that was a nice service. Or that is a nice church. Or you can say, we're going to change. We're going to act locally. And it'll touch globally. It's going to start here. It's going to start in our homes. It's going to start in our own families. It's going to start with a husband-wife relationship. It's going to start with growing that child up the way we should. It's going to start with that child being honorable to the parents and parents being a person worth honoring, to be honest with you. Jenny, you got a song for us? Come up and at least play the piano. I just want to give them a chance to think about this for a second, and then I'll get you out of here. You guys can enjoy this weather. I'm going to ask her to just play something. And as she gets up and starts playing, I just want you to take just a couple of minutes. Examine your gifting. God, what have you blessed me with the ability to do? If I'm doing too much, God, how do I grow up a Timothy? God, put on my heart what I need to focus on. God, if I've been taking baby steps for too many years or making excuses for too many years, or coming in just to put in a little bit of time, and I've been giving you the sacrifice instead of the obedience. God, speak to me. And if you're all perfect, praise God. Somebody's probably already thinking, this is probably for so-and-so. Brother so-and-so needs to hear this one. But right now, as this music's playing, you know what? This is the end. So why don't y'all stand? Just stand for a second. If you want to bow your head. If you want to just think about this, and God, do I fall short? Am I falling short? What do I need to do, God? Your word says, my job is to encourage them. I should encourage. Help me, God. It's my job to teach. Help me to teach. But this one, this part of the service, if there's someone here that's never went to the well, that doesn't know the body of Christ, that's not in the body of Christ, what a special place this is. Talking about a little, I'm not talking about works unto salvation, but I'm talking about a little work that we should do in the body of Christ. But the first step is to be in the body of Christ. And I tell you, it will be a blessing that you cannot contain. And after she's done with the song, I'm going to ask the elders to come up. And if you've never been to the well, if you've never tasted the living waters, if you've never accepted the bread of life, it will sustain you forever. I'm going to ask you to come up. as the elders come up after this song. But right now, examine yourself. She's singing, I want to sit at your feet. Sometimes this morning in worship, I just wanted to sit at his feet. I don't know if it was being too close to Pastor Mike, but I started bawling. It hit me hard. When they sang about that well, I want to be at the feet of Jesus. I really do. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you so much today. I thank you for, if nothing more, the word spoke to me today. God, I pray if somebody else needed to hear this, Lord, that God, that you would help us to step into the role, fulfill the role, fulfill the gifting that you want us and you've given us to accomplish. Like your word says, if it's give, give. If it's encourage, encourage. If it's teach, teach. If it's prophesy, prophesy. If it's help, help. But God, today I recognize that these gifts are from you. God, I hope we all do. So, Father, as we leave here today, keep us safe. Keep us healthy. God, watch over us. Lead us. Guide us. Protect us. And God, help us. Help us glorify you by using this gifting. We praise you today, God. We love you today. I love you today so much. It's in the blessed, blessed, blessed name of Jesus I pray. Amen. If you need prayer, the elders are going to come up. Pray, pray. Don't leave here today in the same condition you came. And I'm done.
Yeah. Yep, that'll be good.
We made it.
Okay.
Make
it
easy.
Yep, we'll see you later then.
All right.
You know, we've had like 5 requests for that song, and I don't get that song. Like, it's not my heart. So Willie's like, we had a song that wasn't working the other night, and he just kept playing it. He just kept playing it and singing it. And so I went, I mean, it's pretty new. So I went to CCI, yep, came right up. I printed it, and everybody's so happy. Which I was that way on Overwhelmed. I never got that song. Well, now I love Overwhelmed. But I didn't like it in the beginning. I don't know why. But so that was good. He just kept going. He just wouldn't stop. He just kept like, he's like, yes!
It's like a lot of stuff. You got to hear it or read it more than once. And try to get, you know, think about what it's
saying. I can't hear harmonies in it. I can't hear. I just don't. Like, musically, I don't get it. So I'll get it. I'll get it. We'll keep singing it. Yeah, I did. It's like Taylor's, our cousin. I saw it. He came with salmon.
Yeah.
What?
We were talking
to
Grandma. Chicken bread.
Oh, yeah. His grandma. Like, my grandma.
His grandma. I'm going to give it to your sister and see what I need to figure out how to do it.
Because I think it's a download.
Yeah, it's a
download. I don't think it's a... I'm sure it's not hard, but it's definitely
bad. Is it a CD?
I think so.
If it is, they must have downloaded it.
Well,
maybe it's not. Maybe it's not. Yeah.
Yeah, it does seem like.